everybody, and welcome to the PC Gamer Show. My name is Tom Marks, Associate Editor here at PC Gamer, and your host, as always. We got a special show for you today. Joining us is Jacob and Leo from Arachnid Games, developers of Diluvion. How you guys doing? Welcome.
Thank you. We're doing mighty fine.
You guys are local, too. It's nice that you could just kind of like hop over the bridge and get here.
Yeah. Our offices are just across the bridge. I live close by, so I slept in today and then rolled down the hill to get here.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, I'm excited to have you guys on. For those, give me the quick elevator pitch of Diluvion, because probably some people haven't heard about the game before, and we're going to be playing it live later, but what can they expect?
Okay. Diluvion is an underwater adventure. It's inspired by Jules Verne's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. And basically, you're the captain of your own submarine. The overarching goal is that there's this treasure of legend at the deepest point in the ocean. So the game is about your journey down to that deepest point.
Cool. And we're also going to be talking about some of the games we've been playing lately, some of the games we want to play. We're also going to be discussing AGDQ 2017, Awesome Games Done Quick, which is going on right now, a very exciting charity live stream event. And then, like I said, we're going to be playing the game later today on the show. And then, of course, taking your questions from Twitch chat. But let's begin the show the way we do every week, which is talking about kind of some of the stuff either we've been playing lately. Obviously, I think the answer for you guys might be Diluvion, as it's coming out in just a month, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Next February? February 10th?
February 2nd.
2nd. Oh, excuse me.
Yeah.
I don't know where I got 10th from. I guess it is...
It's both start with a T.
Okay. Wait a minute.
I don't think your logic checks out. I'm sure most developers can relate to this, especially indies. We've played it so much that we dream about it. It's lost all meaning to us because you're just playing it over and over again. And like, you know, there's QA teams, but in a small team, you still got to play it a bunch.
That sounds like a good game to dream about. Like, I feel like Submarine Dreams is like, that's not a bad way to dream.
If you like dreaming about sinking into an endless abyss, then that is kind of your thing. Then
oh,
yes,
God.
That would be good.
The last bit of air escapes your lungs. No, I haven't actually had a drowning dream, so that's good.
Yeah,
that is good.
Yeah,
I just am picturing like the. Did you guys play Inside at all?
Yes.
It's like that animation of getting pulled out of your submarine by those
people.
That's haunting.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that hasn't creeped into like the what seems to be more like a more fantastical Jules Verne kind of dream.
We toyed with the idea of like showing drowning sailors after if your sub blows up or if you blow up somebody else's sub, but it kind of just didn't make the cut because the tone was a little bit lighter than that, just a smidgen lighter than drowning.
Just a smidgen lighter than dead sailors drowning on screen.
Yeah. Yeah, then seeing all your friends and crew slowly drown.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, no, it's a tad lighter. Actually, I feel like we could have done it, but just we had to be very careful with how we spent our time.
Mm. Gotcha.
Every little thing takes way longer than you'd expect.
Mm. And is that because of the nature of this game specifically, or just kind of game making in general?
Our dev team is three people.
Okay, so, that'll do it then.
I mean, as far as the people actually working in the engine, it's us two.
Wow.
So
everything that's placed in the engine, everything that you actually play has been put there by one of us two, coded by one of us two. The actual art is done by our third member, who's not here right now. He's on a well-deserved vacation. But it's basically just a lot of stuff that we wanted to get in originally, didn't make the cut just because time.
Right.
Just not enough time with four hands.
So when you both have director in your title, and you're just directing yourselves, though,
yeah.
and one other person.
Well, so in my case, like, there's a writer and a composer.
Mm, right.
And the 3D artist that I work with, so I'm kind of like the director of that small team. And then Jacob works with the 3D artist when he's doing stuff that needs to be like rigged, for mm-hmm. example, and he works with the sound design and integration team.
Yeah, so it's and
also, shout out to La Hacienda up in Montreal. They're awesome. Yeah. But that's who we work with for sound design. So yeah, Jacob works with them.
Yeah.
But also director just sounds cool. Even if you don't have much of a team behind it.
What's the point of like starting your own company if you can't give yourself fancy titles?
Right, right.
Yeah.
Well, also I think creative director and technical director are very much like they're iconic titles, right? Like they're titles people recognize of like, oh, he's the creative director of X and Y game, or like the creative right. director of Deus Ex is like a thing that people would recognize.
Mm.
Well, are there any games that maybe you guys are looking forward to playing that you've either been missed, you know, from working on this game, or like are looking forward to playing once the game has shipped officially? Like,
do you want to go first?
Yeah, sure. I mean, there's a lot of the AAA releases over the last couple of months I haven't had time to sit down with. Like, I wanted to try Watch Dogs 2 because I was looking forward to Watch Dogs 1, but it kind of didn't seem to live up to, like, what I was expecting from it. And then the second one seems to actually kind of deliver on the promise that the first one had. Right now I'm playing, like, most of the time I only have time for, like, one or two Dota 2 games. That's what I mostly play.
Oh, cool. And so Dota is, like, it fuels certain people, right? Like, there are people who live and breathe Dota, so it makes sense that you make time for it amongst developers.
Yeah, I just want to point out the sweater now.
Yeah. Oh, is that a Dota sweater?
Yeah. No, this is the shitty wizard from Dota. I like it because it's a placeholder model. It's pretty good.
How long have you been playing Dota?
Since Dota 2 came out, I think.
Oh, wow.
So that's like 6 years now?
Oh, God, is it?
And I was playing Heroes of New Earth before that, which was, like, pretty much a Dota clone.
Right.
For a while.
I remember, because I played League for a number of years, like, pretty religiously, and I remember it was League and Heroes, right?
Yeah,
before Dota 2 came out, it was League and Heroes of New Earth, and, like, Heroes of New Earth, if I remember correctly, was, like, winning that fight. Like, Heroes of New Earth was the more popular game for
a little bit. For a little bit. I think it was, like, the period. Because it started off as a paid game, which I think was a mistake at first, which is why I think League had, like, a huge advantage with that. And then they came out as a free-to-play game, and then they got a big lead, and then Dota 2 came out, and kind of like a lot of Heroes of New Earth people switched over because Valve started supporting the competitive part of Dota 2 pretty seriously.
I remember too when Dota 2 first came out, there was that whole like, at least in my mind, it kind of was weird, like that Valve was like trademarking the name Dota at the time when they had Ice Frog on the development team, and it wasn't like they were just coming out of nowhere, but the name Valve and the name Dota had never been associated up until that point.
Right.
And then suddenly they were trademarking it, and everyone was like, oh, that's okay.
Yeah, exactly.
It's amazing to see how it's grown since then, and it's cool that you've been playing it that long.
Yeah, no, at this point it's kind of like, it's become kind of like my mindless thing that I go home after I've done a day of coding or done a lot of work. So I don't play very well, usually, but I feel like it's kind of a meaningful filling of time for me, I guess.
That's good. Sometimes you need that kind of just let-go game.
Yeah. Recently, like, trying to do ranked and stuff is too stressful, so now I've even gotten even less stressed to do playing Astroneer.
Oh, cool. It's
like the one most recently. It just came out on Early Access.
I was playing that a little over the break. That game's real pretty.
That game is awesome.
Have you seen the concept art for it?
The concept art, no. Oh, I think I might have seen, like, one
incredible
landscape. But
yeah. It's amazing stuff.
The way they use color is actually kind of similar to Diluvion, and, like, lots of, like, blues and kind of pinks and yellows, and it's a lovely, lovely color scheme in that game.
Yeah, it's like they took space, which I think a lot of games that do space have a hard time like making it vibrant.
Mm-hmm.
But Astroneer's is like
it's vibrant and it fits and it makes sense and and just all the mechanics work really well, and just like how the UI, everything is just really intuitive. Like, that's the best part of me. The best part for me is just kind of like the design of like picking stuff out of your backpack, you're placing everything. Everything is done the same way. And so once you've mastered the first thing, you can do everything in the game after that, like pretty simply.
I think it was the first kind of survival-ish, because there's no like hunger or anything like that, but like survival-ish crafting game where I didn't look at a wiki at all while I was learning it.
Absolutely.
And I felt like I actually could play it.
Mm.
I mean, obviously there's things I still don't know in it, but like I didn't feel like I needed to look at a wiki to actually just like get started.
That's called good game design.
Yeah.
I suppose it is.
It really is. It's solving that. It's a problem that a lot of those, it's one of the problems that a lot of those survival games have is exactly that. Like you're kind of like, you don't know what to do at first. Like Minecraft had a pretty good progression, but after a while it started adding a lot more stuff. So now definitely you need a wiki if you want to do some of the more advanced stuff there.
Early Minecraft you could maybe jump into, but late Minecraft was it's tough now to do that.
Got enchantments and stuff. It's crazy.
I think I jumped into Minecraft like 2011, and even then I needed the wiki page to like progress in it because like you get to a point where it's like, okay, I don't know what to do now. Like I need to craft a thing, but I think that's part of why it was so successful is that there was a community built up around it.
Mm. You're talking about Minecraft still?
I'm sorry?
You're talking about Minecraft still? Yeah.
So that people like because it's kind of it's esoteric. Like if you're just gonna play Minecraft by yourself, it's not that fun. But like there's a community around it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And usually like myself and everyone I know that plays Minecraft was introduced to it by a friend. So you would like get to a point you'd have to like call your friend and be like, hey, what's this thing? Like how do I make an oven? I saw you had that, and like you guys talk about it and it like builds up the community, and that's sort of what's fun about it. But I don't think most crafting games can achieve that level of community. Yeah. Some can.
Yeah. Well, so I wanna go back actually to a thing you said, which is like do you see games that require wikis or rely heavily on wikis, like, do you think that is, like, a failure of some kind within the game? Or, because, like, to me, there are certain games where to have the amount of complexity that they want, like, it kind of is almost a necessity that there's this, like, compendium of all that information out there somewhere.
That really depends on who you ask, because some people define failure as, like, that the game as a standalone object couldn't teach you how to play it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas some people, it's like, no, I want something more complex that I want to be able to go out and research it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think there's a single objective answer to that.
Well, what about you? What's your personal opinion on it? And I don't mean like, I don't mean failure in like it's a terrible game. Just like it's like it has fallen short in that regard.
It kind of like failed what we call onboarding. That is like that you get to the mastery of the game, that it smoothly curves you into it.
Yeah.
My opinion on that is that a game should teach you everything that you need to know to beat it. Mm. I feel like for extra stuff, like if there's hidden goodies or like side quests, I feel like it's okay if you have to either research or kind of like look more into things to get that stuff, but you shouldn't need to like go to a Wikipedia page to be able to beat a game.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Watch me eat my own words when somebody like can't beat Diluvion.
Somebody's gonna make a Diluvion wiki and like explain everything.
That's actually what this whole show is. It's a front for just like blackmail material later.
Yeah.
God damn. I've been fooled.
Oh man. It's like now it's on record on the internet. It will never disappear. So.
That's why you should just take my tactic and just don't have opinions about anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
be nihilistic, completely.
Right down the middle.
Dead inside. That's good. Yeah.
We have, like, a lot of differing opinions on game design. So I think, like, when we have our design discussions, we have to always, like, come to a conclusion, which I think is good because it gives both of us perspective. Like, when I watch a stream of, like, Dota or League, I'm like, I have no idea what's going on. It's just, like, magic effects and numbers. Whereas, because he plays it and knows all the stuff, it's like this, like, some incredible thing playing out.
Right,
in his head,
exactly,
but,
yeah.
I mean, like, League, I remember when I played that game consistently, like, and I'm sure this is you for Dota right now, like, without really consciously making an effort to, you know, I knew the name and abilities of every single character, 100 plus characters in that game, and it's like, that's just, like, I couldn't, if someone told me you need to memorize the name and abilities of these 100 characters, I would be like, no. But like just playing the game.
You got there.
Eventually. I got there kind of naturally. It's weird how that happens. And then you don't even realize it when you're watching a game of League or watching a game of Dota. And it's just like, yeah, I understand what's going on, but it looks like, you know, Chinese to somebody else.
You've learned a language, a visual language of what's going on.
Imagine like that's actually more information than knowing like every senator in the country. Like, imagine if someone asked you to memorize the names of every senator, you'd be like, I can name one, maybe.
Uh-huh.
It's like, somebody should make like a Senate version
of
this.
Sounds
like a C-SPAN MOBA league.
Oh my god.
Like, all the abilities are like veto, sign.
Well, you know, I know a developer who's about to launch a game and will have free time, assumedly.
Mm. Yeah.
So this is your next project, is what I'm saying.
We're busy with Stem Collection Simulator after this, so we.
That's the next game.
Yeah, we
look forward to that in 2020.
Oh goodness, what was I going to say? I'm sorry, I'm totally blanking. It was the imagery of a senatorial like MOBA. Just totally sidetracked my brain at that point. But let's talk about, is there anything else you guys wanted to play or looking forward to or something like that? Like, there's a lot of games. We talked about it on the show a couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, there's a lot of games coming out right now.
Yeah, I have a backlog because honestly, this past year, I haven't been playing games much. I've been a gamer for 23 years, but it surprised me to learn that when you start developing, you kind of, like, you do it for, like, 8 to 12 hours a day, and then you get home, it's like, I don't want to look at a video game.
How long have you guys been developing Diluvion?
3 years.
Wow. Cool.
Yeah. But I just finished the campaign of Battlefield 1 and was, like, mega impressed.
Yeah.
Great time. As far as games that I would like to play when we get a break, first off, The Last Guardian. Like, I need a 3-day chunk of time to play the game from start to finish. And then I need a 3-day chunk of time, I'm assuming, to process it, because that's what I needed for both Ico and Shadow of the Colossus, which were the last two games by that designer. Is like, you beat it, and then you're like you have this cathartic moment, and like, nothing else matters.
Yeah.
And you have to like reintegrate into society. It's like getting back from a war. You're just like, what is life? So I'm anticipating that for this one. I hope I get it.
We haven't had the opportunity to talk about Last Guardian on the show because it's not, assumedly, not coming to PC.
Right, exactly.
It's it's a game I'm interested in. Just even, like, I love Shadow of the Colossus, but even just like the story of that game, like how long ago they showed it off and now it's finally actually out, and the reaction was kind of like,
I mean that's kind of like the reason the reaction is like that, because it plays out exactly, it's one of the only games I've played where it plays out exactly on the promise that it had when you first saw it. And so it's like everything that I imagined that game was going to be about, it accomplished in that game. So I mean, when I would call it a perfect game, not because it's the best game in the world, but because it just does everything it's supposed to, exactly the way it's supposed to do it.
In the age of hype and tons of crazy building of expectations, it just met the mark.
It just met.
No Man's Sky.
It just like met it. It was just such a wonderful experience playing that game, and I can't talk too much about it because he hasn't played it yet.
Mm.
But
no spoilers.
No spoilers.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to trying it at some point as well.
If I was going to continue my list of games that I want to play, Bloodborne, I know that's like Slowpoke, but Dark Souls 3.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually haven't played Astroneers yet. I've just seen a lot of the concept art and screenshots, but I definitely want to play that. And forever, I'll perpetually be playing Kerbal Space Program.
Nice.
Mm.
I don't foresee not having fun with that anytime soon.
Yeah.
I played it for like 2 years and I still enjoy like trying new things with space planes. Cause like, it's like Christmas when you log on and there's like new parts. It's just like, yes.
I think that was one of the highest scores we gave to a game when it launched out of early access, not last year, but the year before. We gave it like a 96, which is like one of the highest scores we've given in a very, very long time. Right. I mean, it's kind of insane how good that game is to me, because I told my uncle once removed, I think is the official designation, but like I told my uncle that like his son was like really into techie things and space and that sort of stuff, loves Minecraft, and I gave him told him to play Kerbal Space Program, and this 7-year-old kid was like crazy about it and was like learning about orbits and rocket assembly stuff like that from a video game about silly little green men, and it was, I mean, that the potential of that game is just insane.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
Oh, God. We could do a whole show about Kerbal Space Program.
I feel like you learn more about physics from that game than most physics classes. Like,
yeah.
Just because, like, you...
You see it in action.
Yeah, you see it in action, and you, like, experience it, and it's, like, very visceral, as opposed to, like, looking at equations and...
Hmm. Yeah, it's really, really cool. And I like that it gives you... It gives you the tools to be as specific as you want, or like as kind of in the details as you want, or it gives you the tools to not, you know, to just simplify everything for you and say, okay, if you want to do this sort of burn, like here's the exact trajectory, here's the exact amount of time, you can press this button to automate it if you want, or not. I love that.
Yeah, for the entire first year, I think I built like I would take a solid rocket booster and strap wings onto it and launch it. Like, that's all I did. Like,
it's like the NASA equivalent of a paper airplane.
Just basically.
Tossing out,
yeah.
The day I discovered in that game, I can't remember the name of it. It's a vegetable. I know this is a very, very, very vague way to say it. No, it's the green stocky vegetable.
Celery.
No, that was the name that came
up. Broccoli?
God, we got to keep going.
Kale?
No.
Onion. Oh, is it
asparagus?
Asparagus. Okay.
There we go.
What?
Oh man, what a terrible, terrible divergence this show has taken. just naming vegetables for the next hour.
Welcome to the live stream where we name vegetables.
I think it was called like asparagus fueling or something like that, because you put fuel tanks with boosters around a central rocket and then like band them together with fuel pumps so they like feed one into the next, and it's like super efficient, and the when I learned about that from a YouTube video or a wiki or you know what have you, like that was like an eye-opening experience, and like, oh my god, my rockets can just be so much better now, like this whole new world has opened up, and it wasn't from like an unlock, it was just from a new method of building. I just loved that.
Yeah, no. But when you were describing KSP earlier, that reminded me, like, one of the things I'm going to really sit down with this year that I haven't had an opportunity to is Dwarf Fortress, the latest release. Like, I've been following that game for about as long as I've been following Dota, and that's my special treat. Like, once a year, there's a new patch or a new update with some new content, and just try and make a new fort and hopefully make it not fail.
Yeah, Dwarf Fortress is a game I've never been able to get into. It's just as like it's too intimidating. I'll admit that.
Yeah,
you know,
no,
I'm not gonna be try to make myself be like, oh no, I don't want it. Like it's too intimidating for me.
It's too intimidating for me, and I know C sharp.
Will is saying that he loves Dwarf Fortress. He's really good at it too.
Now, we were talking about onboarding earlier. Like Dwarf Fortress, that's the main thing it lacks. It has terrible onboarding. That's like you have to have the wiki open from the first minute you open that game.
I have a friend who described who first introduced me to Dwarf Fortress and described it as the greatest video game ever made wrapped in the worst looking video game ever made.
Yeah.
And I think it's not an entirely unfair way to describe it.
Not at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's move on. Let's actually talk about AGDQ. So for those people who don't know, this is an event I love to promote every year on the show, or I guess twice a year, because they do Summer Games Done Quick and Awesome Games Done Quick. It's a week-long charity speedrunning live stream, which all of you guys should go to twitch.tv/gamesdonequick, preferably after the show. Or at any point, I think it runs through the end of Saturday, and for seven straight days, they just speed run games and take donations for those speed runs and raise a ton of money for cancer research. And it's just an amazing thing that, like, it's such a great sign of, like, what the games community can, like, come together and just, like, make out of nothing. And now this event is twice right. a year and makes, you know, millions of dollars, like, right. I guess total, right? But it's just such a cool thing. You guys, I think Pat told me you were into AGDQ a bit.
Yeah, I've watched some games done quick in AGDQ, like whenever it's been on the weekends or like when I've had time to do it. My favorite one so far has been watching the Mario Maker races, where they have two teams and they have like the gauntlet of maps from different Mario versions, and they're just like, every time they die, they switch one guy out, and they just like try to get through the whole gauntlet and see who gets there first.
That's funny too, because that's a recent addition to that lineup. Yeah, it's kind of a newer game.
Yeah, because I mean, before it was kind of like I would watch like all the games that I played when I was younger, like watching like Super Mario speedruns, Super Mario World, Super Mario 64, Metroid, Zelda, like those ones. But then when I started seeing this competitive element coming out of it, I was at the edge of my seat, man. Like, you see, like, one team's, like, three maps ahead, and then they just get stuck on one part. And the team's, like, slow. Other teams slowly come catching up, and then they get past that part on the first try, and everybody's just, like, fucking lose their shit. It was really, really good. I really like that. Just the whole initiative and the whole way of playing that game, playing those games, it's just, like, it's a new game. It's a new way of doing it.
Yeah. Yeah, I watched the original Mega Man 4-way race. I think it was like 2 days ago on AGDQ, and they had four people playing the original Mega Man all at the same time. And one of the things I love about watching the races with speedruns of games that are so old is that speedrunners have figured out those games so much that for, you know, 10 solid minutes, all four players will be within, you know, half a second of each other. And they're just, like, all right there, like, going faster than I could ever imagine playing those games. But all of them are just, like, neck and neck, like it's no big deal.
Right.
It's pretty incredible, like, when the one example I can think of, like, the Super Mario 64 speedruns, where people know, like, exactly where to hit the wall so that, like, they go through the collider and, like, get the start. And it's just, like, all stuff like that. There's so many awesome tricks that people learn over the years.
I really like, my favorite one to watch every year is Psychonauts, actually. That's the game I try to hit.
Right.
And they did it a couple days ago. Because it's only like, I mean, this might sound silly, but it's only like an hour. And so, you know, it's like basically for me the same as watching, you know, an episode of television or like two episodes of television on Netflix or something like that. So it's kind of just sit down and enjoy it. And I love that game because they have to play, or they always play the version on PC. They never play the console version. And when the PC version came out, like, it boosted speedrunning, like, insanely. Hmm. Because there's a trick in that game where once you get the levitation ball where you can float, you can fly. Where when you put the ball above your head, you go up a little, like one frame, and then you cancel the ball, and you go up a little bit because he hops, and then you just keep rapidly doing that back and forth, and you slowly gain height, and you fly up. And the thing is, you can only do that trick if the game is running at least 60 frames per second.
Right.
Because the animation is, there's more frames of animation than there are, like, it's more frames than 30 FPS can show. So if they play it on console, that trick just doesn't work.
Right.
But if they play it on PC with an unlocked frame rate, they can just, like, fly anywhere in the game, and they can beat it in an hour instead of, you know, four or whatever.
Right.
It's just nuts.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I love little glitches that become, like, staples of speedruns.
Especially, like, physics-based, like, platforming games where they have those tricks where they conserve momentum.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if they hit, like, an angle or they hit, like, a slope or something, and then you find, like, these paths where you go from slope to slope to slope. A YouTuber that I've watched a lot recently called Pannenkoek something, who does Super Mario glitch runs. He just, like, beats Super Mario 64 with the least amount of A presses possible, like the jump button.
Mm-hmm.
And so he has, like, all these instructional videos on how he does certain maps, and it's just insane. Like, he'll charge up, like, hundreds of thousands of speed on like ramps and stuff, and they just like launch Mario, and his path would be like hitting the ramps in the exact succession he needs to, and it's like it's crazy. It just looks insane.
So, the question I have is, as developers, do those glitches like terrify you or excite you for like when you're making your own game?
Excite.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah,
for sure. Like, our last game that released, Ballpoint Universe, it was in development for like a year and a half. And, you know, we're playing it this whole time. Within the first week it released on Steam, there were people doing better than us. Like, like people just find ways. So it's really cool to see, like, people do things that you never expected.
Yeah. Mm.
And that wasn't, like, an open-ended game, really. It was just kind of like, from the beginning, we were like, all right, we're going to make a shooter, because first game, it's easy to make. And... yeah, so we didn't think there was that much room for, like...
Yeah, we had, like, a platforming segment where you have to, like, get... You do shooting parts, and then you platform around, like, in an overworld to get to the shooting parts. And, you know, it was kind of like the first game that I worked on, so the programming's not entirely awesome, but it's very easy to glitch it out or use the physics in the, kind of like the way I described earlier, and so people can, you know, get over barriers and get places that we didn't think they could, and then... I mean, I think that's fine. Like, I actually want to try and get better at that part of kind of like leaving some of the extremes open-ended.
Mm.
Like, for example, in Diluvion, there's no upper limit to how much you can boost your submarines. And
your,
so theoretically...
Your crew?
Yeah, your crew.
Yeah,
so yeah, if you put... You have a limited amount of crew slots, but the crews themselves have a certain amount of stats. But there's no upper limit to how much stats that these or those crew members can have. So if you get lucky and you grind and you can get like the most extreme crew members... and put them in a slot, then you can get like incredible speeds, or you can shoot incredibly fast, or you can do like a lot of these things. And I didn't want to put like an artificial clamp on how good that can get. I just like, sure, if somebody wants to figure that out and speedrun our game and have submarines going around at light speed, like all the power to them.
That, and you know someone's gonna too.
Oh yeah,
right?
I'm
oh,
looking.
Yeah.
I hope somebody does. I mean, it'll be funny as hell.
I'm really hoping that like. So I know Game Grumps only does console games, but I'm hoping they pick it up for like Steam Train or one of their other, because I've been watching it since the very beginning, and it'd be so crazy to see like this channel that I've been watching for like 5 years play a game that I worked on.
Yeah.
See, that's kind of the other end of the spectrum, right, from speedrunners. Like, no offense to Game Grumps, I love the Game Grumps to death, but like when you put speedrunners next to Game Grumps, they're not quite going for
the
same...
Oh, they're terrible.
No,
yeah, they're not going for the same goal there.
No. No.
But that's the fun part.
They're
too.
Terrible
yeah.
at video games. Like I
they're good at some things. They got a couple games that they
Yeah, there's like three games out of the 500 that they've played that they're proficient at. But like I could just see that, because Diluvion has a decent amount of text. I could just see them like skipping all the text and then beginning to play and being like, what do I do?
So that's like increasingly something that you guys, the developers, just got to start thinking about too, right? Is like, not just, you know, are people going to enjoy this game, but like, how are we going to get people to watch it now?
Mm.
You know, Twitch and YouTube is so much more kind of... Do you feel like it's forced you to consider those as part of the development in a weird way?
Not necessarily in a weird way, but it's kind of... I mean, he's more of grew up on console games, and, you know, you had friends coming over, they'd watch you play if you're playing a single-player game. I had that, too, with, like, Nintendo 64 back in the day, or even just PC games. We'd just have one PC for the family, and then me and my brother would switch off, or, like, he'd watch me play, and then I'd watch him play. And so, like, that kind of comes a little bit naturally, but, like, everybody who gives us advice on marketing and on how to publish games and show games off are definitely saying, like, you need to consider this more, because this is, that's the direction that the audiences are going. They're going to have to watch a game first before they really start putting money into it. And I think that's fair. I think that's, if you can make a game that looks good when somebody else is playing it, I think that's a good sign.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Although not all games types will lean towards that necessarily.
Right.
I don't think it's a like uncomfortable constraint whatsoever.
Mm.
Like there's always been like for the full history of game development or any craft really, there's been constraints. And your creativity kind of arises as like, okay, we have this constraint. Like for example, the NES era, like we can only work with like so many, like we have such a low resolution, we can only work with so many objects. So they had to be creative to like find a way around that to make a game, right? Now, like art, we have so few technical constraints. Mm-hmm. Like we can download an engine for free and start using it and have like all these tools and physics and all that. Anyone can just start doing that. But the constraints are like, okay, the game has to be interesting to watch and like it has to be interesting to talk about. Like the things that you didn't have to consider before, like before Twitch and YouTube and like before that was a factor in if you're competitive or not. But it's just like an evolving market. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's necessarily new to like consider what your market is.
And sometimes it gets better with constraints too. Like having constraints doesn't necessarily make a game worse. On the contrary, I think it forces you to think creatively. And I mean, he's art trained. I went to art school as well before, and this is something that you teach you there as well. It's just like when you're working with a medium of certain strengths or certain constraints, like charcoal versus oil painting versus gouache or any of those things, and you just consider those, you just make it look pretty within the constraints. Like that's all that matters.
Yeah, and I think that's also a feeling that extends past like art and game making for sure. Like everyone feels that even if you go into the, and this is gonna, I apologize, show my, you know, first world privilege a little bit, but like if you go into the kitchen and you have like five different things you could be eating, like it's hard, like you know, yeah. you're like, I don't want to eat anything, right? Yeah. Like you're just like, there's no choice. Like if you are given freedom, if you are given a lot of options, it's harder to like actually like want to start doing something than if you were given these like limited set of things and you gotta like kind of make it work. It pushes your brain to develop that.
Mm.
And in the terms of like Twitch and YouTube too, like I mean I asked if it was more different, but like clearly with AGDQ, like old games weren't thinking about, you know, how they were going to be streamed on Twitch, right, or speedrun or anything like that. And now primarily old Nintendo games seem to be like the majority of AGDQ, or at least what speedrunners love running,
right,
and what people love watching, you know, like the Metroid, right? Super Metroid is like the game that they end the show with every time. And it's always the save the animals or kill the animals going on within that. I think that it's interesting to just see how it's shifted, I guess, rather than how it's like, instead of how it's influenced development, it's like interesting to see how it's shifted just like consumer mindsets.
Right.
Because you don't get many demos anymore, but you can watch an entire game on YouTube the day you get it.
Yeah.
Excuse me. I was very parched after that.
Hey, no, for sure. Yeah, no, I mean, you see that also like, that's why you see games that are very heavily story-based are trying to, like, keep their games kind of hidden or not really showing them off because they feel that if somebody can just watch the whole thing on YouTube, people don't even need to buy it. It's like almost like pirating a movie if it's, like, a really linear story-based game.
Yeah. I have a friend who never played any of the Assassin's Creed games, watched every single Assassin's Creed game from beginning to end in Let's Plays online.
Right.
And the thing about that, obviously he might be an anomaly, but he was never going to play the Assassin's Creed games.
Right, in the first place.
Like, that wasn't like a lost sale or anything. That was just like, he wanted to consume the game that way, you know? Real quick, I do want to say thank you to Bren Dangerous for subscribing. Thank you very much. We appreciate the support. Another question I have. Are there any glitches or any things in the game now that you, like, decided to leave in? You know, like, the glitch that became the feature in a lot of ways that, like, these speedrunning glitches pop up?
I know there are, but I'm can't think of.
I think most of the glitches are going to be left over. It's going to have to do with how much you can upgrade your sub. So if you upgrade your sub to like certain levels or push certain stats like really far, then you can do things that we usually designed against. And I'm not going to go into details because it doesn't make any sense if you haven't played the game.
Hmm.
But there definitely are. I think maybe when we're playing through later, it might come up a little bit easier. But yeah, there definitely are like a lot of. Because our push to this was kind of just, we want to make a game about submarines. It's a fantastical setting, and that's kind of it. And so we start by making controls for submarines, start flying around like this little capsule with a capsule on top. You know, looks like an old submarine or whatever.
Yeah, we have.
Yeah.
You guys brought this nice little model of the ship.
But even before like we started modeling out the ships, it was just capsules, right? And just wanted to see what that felt like. And that kind of informed how we wanted, where we wanted the controls to go and how we wanted it to feel, like ballasting and going up and down. Like, because at the outset, it controls a lot like a space game, but it's underwater, and so there's a lot of different things going on physically.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, it's kind of, I'd almost say like everything that feels about the game has just come from that.
Mm-hmm.
From just trying it out, and sometimes it felt buggy, and then we just like polished it a little bit, and then we just, that's in there now.
Well, why don't we actually move on and show off the game?